And if I come because of the nature of the dispensation, the season that the church has entered into, then I can only come with one purpose, and that purpose is to purify the bride of Christ in the decree of the dispensation of open heaven. Latter glory, latter flow, latter anointing, latter authority, that now the bride of Christ may prepare as an overcomer and prepare righteously and in holiness for the glorious coming of the Messiah. And that is the rapture of the church. The Lord coming for the bride. We see the most recent conversation 2 days ago, relentlessly, one day after the other, he showed me the glory coming and touching down. It was stunning, the most super glory I have ever seen. The Lord has indeed spoken with me over the years and revealed his glory to me in these conversations over the years, relentlessly, continuously, consistently, perpetually, perennially now, about the coming of the Messiah. But we see that the glory that he is now presenting at this time, that is adorning at this time, is super glory. It's a glory that is highly lofty and supersedes, surpasses all the other glory before. And then the glory touches down, and we saw the funnel, the tornado that leaps from the earth, and then the rapture takes place 2 days ago. And we saw after that, again, he comes back and relentlessly shows me again the glory coming from heaven, touching on the earth, opening the wombs, the womb of the earth, opening the tombs, resurrecting the dead, and glorifying, transfiguring, translating the living. And that glory we see is super glorious, and it is like a historic building, one after the other, one tornado on top of the other, and connecting all the way into the kingdom of God Almighty in heaven, and the rapture takes place. And now today, in this same unrelentingness, we see that now he has lifted me above heaven and now showed me the glorious temple. But before he lifts me into heaven, he lifts me above the earth. And above the earth, my raiment becomes transfigured. Totally glorious. And I realize I have been transfigured, translated. And then he shows me the glorious temple. So you can see that the first message the Lord is transmitting to the nation is that, look, the hour has come for open heaven, for this major visitation, for preparation of the raiment for the rapture of the church. The raiment, the super glorious raiment, whose glory supersedes the time before. The raiment for the mighty, most anticipated wedding of the Messiah, the wedding of the Lamb of God. However, I want to move to the second message, the second level. We see very clearly in the book of Revelation that the Lord in this night has spoken a double prophecy. By the same breath, he has spoken, he has foretold about two major dispensations, two major undertakings, events. In the book of Revelation, chapter 11, there are major events that accrue even unto the earth. And these events are directly related with the time of the end, the age of the end of the days, the end of time. And we see that when the rapture of the church takes place, Then thereafter, a series of events begin to roll out upon the face of the earth. And all these events have serious repercussions unto the dispensation that is oncoming, the coming of the glorious kingdom of God. The rapture of the church takes place. The glorious raiments are prepared. The rapture takes place. And the church of Christ enters into the glorious, super glorious kingdom. The dispensation of the kingdom of God in heaven. However, in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 15, coming, emanating out of this message of the temple, this mighty vision of last night, when the Lord lifted me above heaven, and now showed me the temple of the Lord in heaven, including the roof, I could see from the roof down into the temple. What is the message? Now I am reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 15. Again, Revelation 11, verse 15. And this is what he says. From verse 15, this is what the Lord says. He says, and the seventh angel sounded, meaning the trumpet, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, the Messiah, and he shall reign forever and ever. And in Amplified he says, the seventh angel then blew his trumpet, and there were mighty voices in heaven shouting, the dominion, the kingdom, the sovereignty, the rule of the world has now come into the possession and become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, the Messiah. And he shall reign forever and ever, for eternities of the eternities. Verse 16 he says, and the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fall upon their faces and worshiped. In Amplified he says, then the 24 elders of the heavenly Sanhedrin who sit on their thrones before God prostrated themselves before him and worshipped. So this is very powerful. I am coming to the significance of the glorious temple that the Lord has shown me in this mighty vision last night. What is the second message to the church? The first one we have seen that he is saying, build for me a similar copy. I want to come. Time has arrived. I must come and dwell among my people. And because we are in such a time as this of preparedness, that dwelling can only translate into the preparation of the super glorious transfigured raiment that I had this night, even above the earth, as the Lord was taking me into heaven. And that is the trajectory, the spiritual path that the raptured church will follow. The Lord is now putting into practice the mechanistics, the mechanism, how the rapture of the church will take place. This is the undertone in this conversation. underpinnings of this mighty discourse. And I say it is the preparing. The visitation is here, and the preparedness, the anointing, the flow is here. The latter rain is here. The latter glory has befallen, behold. And it's all for preparedness, for the going, for the taking away, for the gathering, for the lift off, the lifting off of the church, the bride of Christ, holy church, righteous church, church without a blemish, without a stain, without a wrinkle, a mature bride, in one accord, perfect bride. But in observing the requirements of this visitation, the must needs of this visitation, we see that there is a second message. And that message propels the nations into the dispensation post-rapture. And so we see that in this conversation, the Lord is saying that when the seventh angel blows the last trumpet upon the breaking of the seventh seal on the scroll of God, then we perceive, we begin to understand, we transduce the message of this temple visitation, temple vision last night. And we see that when the angel blows the last trumpet of the seven, that trumpet brings in the seventh bowl of judgment that will consume in the last 3.5 years. Remember, after the rapture, we have the 3.5 years when there will be a very serious contestation between the forces of righteousness and the forces of evil. But at the end of the first season of the 3.5 years, then ushers in the next season of the 3.5 years, the last 3.5 years, in order to conform to the 7 years post-rapture, after which the Messiah comes. That is the journey I am walking with you today, that you may deeper understand the message the Lord has spoken this night on the glorious temple in heaven. And I said it transcends beyond even the preparedness of this hour, even the rapture that's about to happen, and then it pushes, propels the nations into the post-rapture, and hence the ushering of the dispensation of the kingdom of God take hold. And you see very clearly, precious people, that that trumpet of the seven brings in the bowl, the vial of judgment that will occur in the last 3.5 years after the heavy contestation of the first 3.5 years, post-rapture, after the bride has been taken. During this time, the bride of Christ is in heaven already, and she's already enjoying the wedding feast of the Lamb, the wedding supper of the Lamb, the fellowship with the Messiah and his God, our Father. We see that the Lord has indeed spoken very major. And we see very clearly further on that there will be the last judgment, this particular one I'm talking about, when now finally the seventh trumpet blows. Of course, after the breaking of the seventh seal, it becomes the last judgment. And this is the judgment that cleanses the earth. The purpose is to clean up the earth in preparedness for the coming of the Lord Jesus, who will actually now come and set up his throne on the earth, set up his kingdom on the earth. It is also the last word, one of the last curses that comes upon mankind. Hallelujah. And he says that when this trumpet is blown, then the kingdom of heaven, all the world, the kingdoms of the world are given unto the kingdom of the Lord. This is the preparedness, the preparation that dismantles evil, to prepare the earth, because the church is already with Christ in heaven, and they are preparing to come to Jerusalem. This was indeed a profound conversation this night. He spoke to the church that at that time, the Lord Jesus will take the kingdom of heaven unto the earth. But first, it is the rewarding of the saints in heaven at the wedding feast of the Lamb. And the earth must be cleansed, cleaned out of evildoers, the enemies of God. We know that that comes when the deception has already taken place. I told you, there has been a 3.5 years, the first season of serious contestation to defy the forces of evil, to fight them that are coming to delude and to lie, deceive men. And people are deceived. So in this conversation, you see that the authority to rule the earth that the Lord is talking about was already given to Christ. We saw on the cross at Calvary that he defeated evil, and he got the authority even in Revelation chapter 6, where there was nobody to break the seals of the scroll. Then all of a sudden they said, the Christ, but the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has already triumphed on the cross. So he is more than capable to break the seals of the scroll and usher the nations and the church into this wonderful unfolding dispensation of the coming of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I am reading Revelation chapter 11, verse 18, to advance you further as I unfold to you what is the deeper revelation on the vision that the Lord spoke with me this night, in which he lifted me up above the earth, made my raiment totally transfigured, super glorious, and then he lifted me into heaven in a simulation of the trajectory, the path, the spiritual path that the bride of Christ would follow. And when I entered heaven, then he lifted me above heaven and he showed me the super glorious, mighty temple of the Lord in heaven. I am now rolling you into the second message. The first one, I said, the visitation and the glorious preparation of the raiment. And then for rapture, for the wedding of the Lamb. But the second message here in this conversation, you see now, it transcends beyond this dispensation. And that's why I'm walking you from Revelation 11, verse 15, stepwise, baby steps, step by step, that you may see the unfolding and then the deeper message from the temple in this vision. And he says here, Revelation chapter 11, verse 18, he says, and the nations were angered, and thy wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets. Again, and it says, that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. And Amplified says, verse 18, it says, and the heathen, the nations raged, but your wrath, retribution, indignation, came the time when the dead will be judged. Again, I repeat, Amplified. He says, verse 18, Revelation chapter 11. He says, the heathen, the nations, raged. But your wrath, retribution, indignation, came the time when the dead will be judged, and your servants the prophets, and the saints rewarded. And those who revere, fear, your name, both low and high, and small and great. And the time for destroying the corruptors of the earth. Precious people. Why is he saying that the nation are angry? They will become angry in that hour. And I'm talking about the blowing of the seventh trumpet after the breaking of the seventh seal. The seventh seal is broken, and then now the trumpet blows. Those events happen at the same time. The seventh trumpet, and then the seventh bowl, the bowl of judgment now is unleashed, poured out unto the nation. And I'm walking you to the meaning of this temple, the message therein. Why is he saying the nations are enraged? Because you see, at that time, even Isaiah the prophet, Jeremiah the prophet, they already proclaim about the counterfeitness of the nation. How evil. Everybody knows today that the nations have subscribed to a higher level of evil. And they have become a confederacy, a coalition. They have built alliances with the forces of this world. And that's why any events that begin to unfold out, to roll out, the dispensation of the kingdom of God on the earth must be resisted. That's why you see, he says, they're enraged, they're angry, they're heathen. However, to best understand this, I want us to read the book of Psalm chapter 2. What I'm giving you today is absolutely very deep. I have kept it until this conversation took place this night. Then this now, I realized, becomes the hour to mature the church. To give you this truth, to understand this deeper, the book of Psalm 2, to build up on Revelation 11 verse 18. And he says, the book of Psalms, chapter 2, he says, why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine a vain thing? He says here very clearly, in verse 2 of Psalms, chapter 2, the kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together, confederacy of course, against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, verse 3, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us, meaning have no covenant with the anointed of the Lord. Break the link, that's what he's talking about. Verse 4, he says, he that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Verse 5, then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Verse 6, yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. That is now the coming of the kingdom, and he's talking about the vexing of them, the derision, that he shall vex them in his displeasure. And he says now, verse 6, yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. Verse 7, I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son. This day I begotten thee. Verse 8, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance. The nations, he says, the heathen for thine inheritance, and the outermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Verse 9 he says, thou shalt break them with the rod of iron. So he's saying that the king that he's bringing to reign over this earth, to establish the reign of God over this earth, and that king we know is the Messiah, he will come with an iron scepter. That's what he's saying here. And that's why in Psalm chapter 2, he's now expounding. The book of Psalms 2 is now opening up that you may understand the conversation that the Lord had with me this night to relate to you, and how that conversation propels our thinking, our notion, beyond this dispensation into the next dispensation of the coming of the glorious rule of God unto the face of the earth. And he's saying, I will declare, verse 7, the decree. The Lord has said unto me, thou art my son. This day I begotten thee. Verse 8, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the outermost part of the earth for thy possession. Verse 9, thou shalt break them with a rod of iron, meaning iron scepter that you see in Revelation. He shall rule with an iron scepter. Thou shalt break them with the rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel, meaning you shall crush them and they shall shatter in pieces the kings of this world, the kingdoms of this world. Verse 10, it says, be wise now, therefore, all ye kings, kings of the earth, of course. He instructed, ye judges of the earth, serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Verse 12, he says, kiss the Son, lest he be angry and ye perish from the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. So you see very clearly why the nations are angry when this kingdom of God will be established. And I'm talking about this conversation last night, and I began with the breaking of the seventh seal and the opening up of the bowl, the seventh bowl of judgment on the face of the earth, that you may understand the message the Lord spoke, that the church may be mature today. He says that the world of this hour is indeed about to endure, just about to endure the seventh bowl of judgment of the wrath of God. He says that when that wrath of God will be happening, the dead in Christ, they are to be judged in heaven. And that tells me they were raptured with Jesus. He says, they will be judged in heaven by Jesus the Lord, the Messiah. And they will be given rewards. They will be rewarded and given positions of authority for the works they allowed the Spirit. Why? Because they allowed the Spirit of the Lord to use their bodies then when they were alive. That is the reason they are now being judged as this is happening on the earth. That's why he brought in the dead, that the dead shall not be judged, but they will be judged in heaven, the dead in Christ. He's talking about the first resurrection. Those that raptured with the church, with the living church that was transfigured, translated. That is the transfiguration that you see the Lord brought me about the earth and transfigured me. And when I looked at the raiment, it was super glorious, my raiment. And yet, when also I looked at my countenance, I realized I had been transfigured. That is the resurrection of the dead church, the dead in Christ, and the translation of the living church, the only living, the only dead, and raptured. But he's saying, as the breaking of the seventh seal takes place now, after the 3.5 years post-rapture, heavy contestation between evil and good, now I am talking about the next 3.5 years towards the 7 years post-rapture. And I'm moving towards the temple in heaven. What message does it behold to the church today after this visitation here, this mighty vision? And now you see that as the breaking of the seventh seal and the opening of the seventh bowl of judgment on the face of the earth takes place, the church is already in heaven. The dead in Christ are judged in heaven at that time by the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And I've said that they are given rewards and positions of authority for the wonderful works they allowed the Spirit of the Lord to do through their bodies. That is the only reason they are rewarded. Even you that are alive today, the question then becomes, how much have you allowed the Spirit of the Lord to use your bodies today for the wonderful works of this coming dispensation, the coming Messiah? That is the only reason the church will be rewarded. And he says that this is what gives the church today a hint of the judgment seat of Christ that occurs at the same time when the armies are being gathered on the earth here for this destruction. I know I'm jumping a little bit ahead of you. I'm introducing the army being gathered for judgment. But I already read for you that he comes with an iron rod. We read in Psalm 2 when he's warning the kings of the earth. But when you go to Revelation chapter 19, after the rapture of Revelation 19 verses 6, all the way to verse 10, after the rapture now, you see verse 11 on, he is talking about the heavy contestation, the deception, the delusion by the Antichrist, the false prophet, and that evil triunity of the devil with them, counterfeiting worshipping of God, bringing the abomination that causes desolation. At that time, when the Messiah is about to come, see now, when they begin to wage war against Israel, then they are all gathered and they are destroyed by God, by the coming of the Messiah, by the sword of his breath, his tongue, his mouth. That is what the Lord is talking about here in Psalm 2, when he's warning the kings and he's saying the Messiah comes, he's warning the kings of the earth that please kiss him. He's saying, kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and ye perish, verse 12 of course, ye perish from the way, and when his wrath is kindled but a little. And he says, blessed are they that put their trust in him. He's warning the kings of the earth that look, he's coming with an iron scepter, an iron rod. And that iron rod comes to crush the armies of the earth, the kings of the earth, the generals of the earth, the armies of the earth that had formed a coalition with the Antichrist. And I'm using this to build a foundation as I slowly walk you into the deeper message of the glorious temple in heaven that the Lord showed me this night. What it portends into the coming dispensation post-rapture. You can see that the Lord is already speaking beyond rapture. That should really ring bells into your hearts and minds and souls and lives and salvation. But why is the Lord now speaking in the dispensation beyond the rapture of the church, the wedding of the Lamb? And that's why he warns here. And he says that this is the time also when the sheep, the bride of Christ, are being blessed in heaven, rewarded. But the armies are also being gathered for destruction. And he says that at that time, it will be only a short time between the rewarding in heaven and the armies being gathered here. That time frame is almost the same. And the Messiah comes. The gap is very small, that's what I'm saying. And he says, the nations will have been deceived. But I want to go to the most important just now. Now, Revelation chapter 11, verse 19, finally, about the temple. And he says, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament, the ark of his covenant, the ark of God. And there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. I want to bring your attention to something very critical here. That's why I deliberately began you on this journey. I remember way back, it was around August of 2003, when the Lord was beginning to speak with me consistently about the coming of the Messiah. I remember too well that the Lord at that time, in one of the visitations when he was calling me, he lifted me up above the earth and he took me into heaven, into his temple, the throne room. And I remember at that time, he showed me the ark of the testament of the Lord, the ark of the testimony of God, the ark of the covenant of God in heaven, the ark of the new testament, the new covenant. And I remember at that time, let me go stepwise here, he placed the Bible inside the ark of the covenant, and I could see from where I was the Bible inside the ark of the testament of God. And then a lightning struck the Bible. It struck the Bible there. Lightning struck the Bible, and the Lord made me know that the Bible is now openable. Then I saw the Bible inside the ark of the covenant of God in heaven. In that mighty vision, the Bible was now opened. And when the Bible was opened, then at that time, again, the lightning, I want to repeat here, struck the Bible three times. And I preached this across the entire earth. From continent to continent, I preached the meaning of why the lightning struck the Bible three times. But at that time again, an earthquake hit the ark of the covenant of the Lord. A huge earthquake. And the meaning that earthquake also touched the earth down on the earth. And I kept preaching all over the earth. The Lord himself in that vision, in that visitation, revealed to me that the lightning stands for the power, the authority, and the judgment of God against sin. I am very astonished to meet it again here. And he's saying now that at this point, all of a sudden, now the temple of God is visible from the earth. In verse 19 of Revelation 11, he says, the temple of God, when the Messiah comes, will now be visible from the earth. People on the earth will be able to see the temple of God in heaven. When the Messiah comes back to Jerusalem after 7 years post-rapture, coming back with a raptured face, they have been rewarded, they have been given positions of authority at the wedding feast of the Lamb. They have been given reward, they have been judged by Christ the Messiah. Now they have come to Jerusalem. But he's saying from the earth, behold, they will be able to see inside the temple of God in heaven, and they will see for the first time again the ark of the testament of God. The ark of the covenant of God. It will be a stunning time. It will be such a revealing time. It will be a historic moment. A beautiful time on the earth. But what is the meaning of this? He says, when the temple is open in heaven, and the world sees the ark of God's testament in that temple in heaven, they will be able to see that the pattern of that ark of the covenant is what was actually used by Moses to build the ark of the covenant that was on the earth. They will be able to see the faithfulness of the first ark of the covenant. They will be able to see, when they look at the temple in heaven, and they see the ark of the testimony of God, they will be able to see that it was a copy. What was on the earth was actually a copy of what was there. But we know it too well that the ark of the covenant of the Lord on the earth contained three things. It contained Aaron's rod, which had flourished, which was budded. And I'll tell you that that was the symbol of approval of God over his high priest. But let me first tell you what was contained before I give you what each represents. But the copy that the Lord allowed Moses to build on the earth, the people of the earth will now be able to see, look, wow, it was the exact copy of what was on the earth. And yet the one on the earth contained the rod of Aaron, Aaron's budded rod, which was the symbol of approval of Jehovah over his high priest. You remember the contestation between Aaron and the other false priests. When finally the Lord said, put all your rods here, and whosoever his rod shall bud tomorrow, that is the one I've chosen. The next thing that was contained was the manna. The manna, the jar of manna, which is the bread that descended from heaven to the house of Jacob. And the next thing was the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments of the Lord. So these actually represented God's choice for the priest, for the high priest, God's favor over the high priest. And the manna, the jar of manna, represented God's supernatural bread of life. That is God's supernatural bread of life that came from heaven, descended from heaven. And we know who he is. The bread of life. And the Ten Commandments that Moses wrote and placed there, they represent God's eternal law. So even when that dispensation comes, after you, the raptured church, have gone to heaven, have been rewarded and given positions of authority to reign with Christ, and you have come back to Jerusalem, then you will be able to watch, when you look up, you will be able to see from the earth the temple of God in heaven, and therein you will be able to see the ark of the testament of the Lord. I am now revealing to you what that will signify. Hallelujah. That when the ark of the Lord is seen from the earth, that will be the final testimony to Israel, to the people of Israel, to the nation of Israel at that time, and to the people of the world, that the God of heaven has now made an eternal covenant with Israel. Again, I said that when the people that were raptured have come to the earth, the confederacy of evil that was post-rapture on this earth has been destroyed. And as you begin to wield authority here, the raptured church has come, the Messiah, to Jerusalem, post-rapture 7 years after. And you look up and see the temple of God from the earth, you see the temple of God in heaven. Very stunning time. And when you will be able to see, and therein you will be able to see the ark of the testament of God, he says, from the one of the earth that contained Aaron's budded rod, symbol of approval of the priesthood, the jar of manna, the bread that descended from heaven, the eternal bread of life who is Christ for us, Hallelujah. And then the written tablets of the Ten Commandments. For me, I've told you the vision when the Bible is inside the Ark of the Covenant, that now will represent to the nations the eternal covenant. The Lord will have now again activated upon the face of the earth, in the viewing of all the nations of the earth, the eternal covenant that he has with Israel. Which means in that dispensation, now Israel is beginning to come on board. The Jewish church, the Messianic Jewish church, the Jews are now coming. Israel, the house of Jacob, is now coming on board. What a mighty dispensation. And representing God's choice for the priest. And then he says further on here, the everlasting covenant with Israel, that's what I said, is going to be activated. The restoration of Israel. And God will also decree his laws over his chosen priests to rule in his kingdom from Jerusalem with Christ the Messiah. But I want to bring something to your attention here. Why is it that when the Lord now shows me that dispensation and the Ark of the Covenant, the glory is not sitting on the mercy seat at this time? Why is it that he did not show me the glory sitting on the mercy seat? Because the dispensation of mercy shall have passed, shall have been surpassed. The dispensation of the grace that was birthed out, revealed to the church and the nation and humanity, mankind, on the mercy seat when the blood of Jesus was sprinkled upon the face of the mercy seat. And the glory sits on it to bring the dispensation of the grace to the church and to the world and to mankind, to the earth, to redeem humanity. That dispensation shall have surpassed. That's why you see, when I saw it now, I don't see the mercy, the glory on the mercy seat. I just want to bring that to your attention. That at this time, as they are seeing, the glory is not sitting on the mercy seat. Why? Because the dispensation of mercy, of grace has surpassed, and the Lord Jesus, with the raptured holy saints, he will rule now with an iron scepter. When he says homosexuality is sin, it will be sin. When he says sexual lust is sin, it will be sin. It will never be coated with sweet caramel or painted white in any way, form, or shape. When he says perversion, the gospel of prosperity, when he says falsehood, all these things that you see have marooned and have actually plagued the church. When he says it will be sin during that reign of Christ, they will be called sin. In other words, a spoon will be called a spoon and a spade a spade. And he talks of the lightning and the voices that are thundering and the earthquakes and the great hail, which are just but a description, precious people, of the bowl, that seventh bowl that pours of judgment. It is poured out. But it's so amazing that the temple can be seen from the earth. The thought that there will be a temple seen from the earth, I want to make this clear. The fact that they will see the temple from the earth, it will not mean that physical temple exists in heaven. Why do I say so? Because you see, he says that in the all out towards the New Jerusalem from that point on, that then the God of heaven and his Lamb, the Lamb of God, and the people, the saints that worship, will worship in the New Jerusalem. He says that there will be no temple because they will be the temple. They shall constitute the temple. That the throne of God will be there. The throne of the Lamb will be in that heaven of eternity. And the Lamb, he says, and the people that dwelleth therein, he says, that they shall make up that temple. So the Lord this past night spoke in very major three major ways. He revealed that the rapture of the church is very near. And he revealed to his servant that the moment for which to prepare a glorious raiment for the wedding feast of the Lamb is now. And he simulated that by lifting his servant above the earth with a glorious raiment into heaven, meaning following the spiritual trajectory, the spiritual trajectory that the church will follow as she enters heaven from the earth. After they be falling to the glory of the earth, lift up through the trajectory into heaven. Then again he lifted me above the earth and showed me the temple of God in heaven, speaking about the post-rapture dispensation. Today the Lord has spoken to the nations of the earth. Hasn't the Lord spoken with you? Hasn't Jehovah spoken with you? The coming of the Messiah is near. Prepare unto yourselves that glorious raiment I saw this night. Prepare because the time to be lifted up and transformed and transfigured and given eternal bodies is now nigh. Very, very near. The rapture must now happen. May those who have ears listen to what the Spirit of the Lord says to the nations. Shalom.